Okay, so without further ado, I want to introduce you to our topic and our speaker. So today's topic is strategic budgeting for optimal financial and operational efficiency. This is the perfect time to talk about budgeting because if you're on a calendar year, you're probably beginning to think about your 2022 budget. It's hard to believe that we're over halfway through 2021 and now looking into 2022. So today you'll learn tips to enhance your organization's financial health, especially looking at your budget as we continue through this COVID era. So now I want to introduce you to our speaker, Kim Jolley. Kim is the Interim Vice Chancellor for University Advancement and Interim Executive Director for USC Upstate Foundations. She comes to Upstate from SunTrust, where she has 11 years experience as President and Commercial Relationship Officer in Spartanburg, but she has more than 30 years of banking experience at several locations. She has an extensive background with nonprofit boards and community organizations, including past president and board member of Mobile Meals of Spartanburg, serving on the advisory committee of the Women's Leadership Council for United Way of the Piedmont, serving as a board member of Spartanburg Economic Futures Group, and also the Chapman Cultural Center. In 2012, then Governor Nikki Haley appointed Kim to the Westview Fair Forest Fire Commission Board, on which she currently serves as chair. And Kim lives with her husband, Rick, and her daughter, Linza, here in Spartanburg. So we want to welcome Kim today to share with us. And Kim, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Ashley. I appreciate it. So in thinking about this presentation, I thought I would do it as the top 10 best practices for budgeting during COVID-19. So Ashley, if you want to turn the page. So number 10, negotiate with vendors and suppliers. Many service providers are willing to work through COVID-19 related hurdles in order to keep you as a client. We took a look at our memberships, our nonprofit affiliations that require some type of membership, and subscriptions, and we decided whether, you know, those were really necessary for us to have, and if they were necessary resources, we went to that company and told them, you know, that our budgets were being constrained due to COVID-19, and talked to them and asked them if they could reduce our fees. And many of them were willing to do that to keep us as a client. So we were very lucky that we were able to do that. Ashley, if you'll turn the page. Number 9, stop unnecessary spending and save as much cash as you can. As you know, cash is king and can help you in many situations. One thing that we did was we cut out completely travel budgets. So no one, obviously during COVID, was allowed to travel. And so we took everything virtual. So I think all of us are very used to having Zoom and team meetings now. And we probably will continue that in the future. It is a time saver as well as a money saver. You save travel time, you save money by not traveling. So I think this will become a way of life for all of us in the future. Okay, Ashley. Number 8, do more with less. Place that job vacancy on hold. If someone leaves, don't immediately replace the position. I think we've all learned that as well. And there are some There are some positions that you absolutely have to replace, but there are some that you can look at and maybe put on hold and do more with less, you know, kind of divide those duties between several people until there comes a time when you feel like you can adequately replace that position. Okay. And then number 7, trim the fat, review existing contracts with consultants to see if you can cancel without penalty or reduce the amount of services being provided. We had consulting contracts with fundraising companies, PR companies, CRM consultants, and we renegotiated terms with them, or a lot of times in your contract, you'll have an opportunity to cancel if you give them 30 or 60 days notice. So we reviewed all of our contracts, and there were some that we reduced the amount. There were some that we gave them a 30-day notice and ended up canceling. We still remain friendly with those consultants because at some point we probably will pick up our relationship and continue that relationship with them. But for the time being, we just felt that we needed to save some money. And so that's what we did. We had consultants we were talking to about a capital campaign. And obviously COVID-19 hit, and it was not a good time at all to do a capital campaign. So we put that on hold and just let those consultants know that. Okay, Ashley. Number six, try not to tap into your resources. You've got your operating funds that you need to use on a daily basis, but you also have those strategic investments. You have those reserves. Try not to tap into those, but if you do need to tap into them, try to pay yourself back as soon as you can, even if it's a monthly payment like you would set up for a house or a car loan or a building. Just make yourself a payment so that you can recoup those reserves, because there may be another time that you need those. You know, we've seen economic downturns. We've seen the pandemic. There's just always seems like something that comes up that you may need those reserves for. So if you do tap into them, can you hear me now? Okay. Yeah. So there's always probably some reason that you're going to need reserves. So just make sure you repay yourself if you do tap into them, but try your best not to. Okay, Ashley. Number five, it's okay to pull the plug on a project. We had many projects this year that we pulled the plug on. We just felt like we could not effectively execute the project, or there were times when COVID got in the way. We had people who had quarantined, and so we just felt like we needed to put that project on hold. That does not mean that we won't pull that project back out in a couple of years and use it. But just right now, we felt like there were times that we had projects that we just wouldn't be able to execute efficiently or to, you know, the standard that we're used to. Okay, Ashley. Number four, and this is one I truly took advantage of, we implemented a zero-based budget. And this expense management strategy requires finance executives to question and justify each line in their budgets from the bottom up. I found this article. It was by Kristen Broughton in the Wall Street Journal. And so I really took that to heart when I found it last year. And that's how we managed our budget for 2020-2021. The departments in my area were not given a budget at all. The manager of that department and I talked every month about costs for the upcoming month. And we decided together the costs that we could justify and the expenses that we just really felt like we could not afford. So we really truly implemented this zero-based budgeting tactic, and it worked well. Okay. And so number three, collaborate with other nonprofits in your community. Spartanburg's a great community and we have great nonprofits and we like to collaborate, which is really important. So this is the one thing I think that makes Spartanburg unique, that there's so many nonprofits that have joined together and collaborated on a project or an event. And so there's always people in Spartanburg looking to collaborate. Next slide, Ashley. So, can anyone write this in the chat? Can you tell me the word associated with this classic scene from the sitcom Friends? Does anybody remember this this show and this scene? That's it. I see Sharon Pittman, pivot. Yes, that's exactly right. So the number two out of my top 10 is to pivot. Think about other ways to bring dollars in the door. We were so used to asking donors for money. We started looking for more grant dollars. We researched grant makers that had a focus on higher education and spent a lot of time doing that research and reaching out to those nonprofits or those foundations to see if they were interested in learning more about USC Upstate Foundation to help our students. And the number one, continue to engage in your donors and make the ask. We have found this year that, you know, at first we were scared to reach out because we really didn't know what was going on with the pandemic, but people that we've reached out to have been engaged. They've made donations. You know, they're still willing to help our students, still help willing to help USC Upstate, and they want to see our students be successful and get that college degree. So we've continued to make the ask and connect with our donors. So I'm going to open it up. Does anybody have any tips that they'd like to share that they have implemented? You can write those in the chat. Happy to hear from anyone else who may have had a tip that I didn't think of.
Kim, I'm wondering if you could speak a little more on the zero-based budgeting and how you approach that, where we know nonprofit organizations are really operating on a very, I guess, thin or a flat budget. When everything seems essential, how do you go about making those difficult decisions of budget cutting?
It was really hard. You know, each of my departments had good justification for doing their work and needing the dollars. And I just really had to look across the board and see what items were most effective and the goals that we wanted to accomplish. And so, yes, there were some projects and some programs that got cut. There's some that got put on hold, but we, you know, it wasn't a direct no, it was, you know, not right now. And so we had to make hard decisions, as all of you have had to make hard decisions in your nonprofit world. So it's just, it continues to be a challenge. You know, we thought things were going to open back up, and here we are again looking at you know, the possibility of things. I don't think everything will close down, but we certainly are starting to wear masks again and be a little bit more careful and cautious than we were when we thought, hey, everybody's been vaccinated. And that's not the case. So unfortunately, we are still looking at some of our programs and trying to decide if we need to still put some things on hold. Anybody else have any questions or comments about things that you've done in your nonprofit world that maybe I haven't thought about? I know we have reallocated some of our funds as well. We have a discretionary fund, and we reallocated some of the dollars to help some of our students. We made sure that we want to make sure that we retain our students, and some of the challenges that they may have is they may have been laid off from work. They may not be able to afford their books. And so we have reallocated some of our discretionary dollars to help students pay for books through our bookstore, which also helps our vendor at the bookstore. So just looking at different ways we can allocate dollars to help our students be successful. Ashley, I think I saw some things in a chat of ways that people thought about as far as budgeting goes.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Diane said goal setting makes sense to make sure of the value of each activity. Project and ongoing practice is necessary at this time. Absolutely. So really aligning to your comments around around zero-based budgeting, really streamlining and connecting those items back to your organization's goals.
Absolutely. That's a good one.
Well, while others are thinking about questions, Kim, I know you had, I'm going to share my screen again. You also had some slides about risk management, and especially around cybersecurity, which I know is something that we have paid a lot of attention to this year because there's just been such an increase in cyber attacks. I'm going to share that.
Absolutely. I wouldn't be a good banker if I did not talk about this. So my risk management tip of the day is to review your insurance coverage. Sign up for cybersecurity insurance if you do not have coverage. This should be a critical component in your risk management strategy. I have seen this firsthand last year, and I can tell you exactly the date. On July 17th of 2020, I received an email from Blackbaud saying that they had had a security breach. So it was a third party data breach, and they notified us. And so in turn, we hired some cybersecurity attorneys, and we had to notify our donors. We also had to notify our students. If you remember back in the day when many of us were in college, our college ID number was our Social Security number. And so some of our systems still had that Social Security number in the computer, and it was not encrypted. And so we spent over $50,000 last year with this data breach that was not one of ours and was not caused by us. It was caused by a third party. So ransomware attacks, you can flip the page. Ransomware attacks increased 62% from 2019 to 2020, with 304 million attacks reported in 2020, according to Statista. According to Harvard Business Review, the amount companies paid to hackers in 2020 grew by 300%. The sudden increase in remote work and lax security protections at home gave hacker groups the perfect opportunity to breach sensitive data. So what is ransomware? Ransomware is a form of malware that infects a computer or a network, encrypting the data, rendering it unusable. Generally, the attack's perpetrators offer to provide a key to the victim so they can unencrypt the data and return it to a usable state. However, to receive the key, the victim must pay a ransom. The perpetrator typically requires the victim to pay the ransom with cryptocurrency or Bitcoin. If the victim pays the ransom and the hackers provide the key in return, the victim can recover their data. Unfortunately, in some cases, the hackers receive the ransom but do not provide the recovery key, leaving the victim without their data and the money paid. Ransomware, unfortunately, remains a real and persistent threat. If you fall victim to ransomware, you have three options. You recover your data from a backup, pay the ransom, or lose your data forever. And we did see this with Blackbaud. They did recover their key, and the attacker said that they did not do anything with the data, but Blackbaud did pay a ransomware fee in Bitcoin for that attack. And it, I don't think that Blackbaud realized the extent that their customers utilized their database systems and the areas that folks put information in. And so I know I've sat in on many Blackbaud conferences over the past year, and they have virtually encrypted a lot of their data that was not encrypted before. So make sure that you have cybersecurity insurance. Check that and see. It would help if you did. You know, it's just like every other insurance policy where you're paying for it and you may not ever use it, but it certainly does come in handy if you do need it. So that's my risk management tip of the day.
Yeah, Definitely. That's so relevant because I have friends that work at two other for-profit companies in Spartanburg, and they've both had ransomware attacks where they've had to pay. And then our office, we have undergone training around cybersecurity and the importance. And I mean, I can personally see the amount of emails uptick and trying to get you to click this link. And that just, I know we're talking about budgeting, but that ultimately is impacting the budget, especially if you have to pay that ransomware.
Absolutely.
We've got a couple of questions in the chat. Teresa, I see your comment. And we'll give you time. I want to address Sharon's question first. So Sharon asked, have you seen donor giving increase, decrease, or stay the same?
You know, I have seen donors increase. So we had an increase from over 2019 to 2020. So this year we did see an increase as well. So it had dipped for a while, but then it came back up. So I think folks started seeing that there were nonprofits that were in trouble, and the nonprofits that they really care about, I think they dipped into their wallet and made some donations. Yeah. Has anybody else seen anything differently than that?
Please feel free to put that in the chat. That's an interesting, interesting question. I know there's been a lot of conversation around donor giving and the concern around donor fatigue, but if you just want to say increase, decrease, stay the same from 2019 to 2020 or 2020 to 2021. And while folks are thinking about that, Teresa, I know you said you had a question, so I'll let you go ahead and ask that.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I'm sure Ashley is probably has figured out what I'm going to ask. Angels Charge Ministry, nonprofit, this did not happen to them in terms of the attack or whatever, but my own personal email system that I send out stuff to, somebody got into that and sent out emails, I guess to all of my contacts, and it was signed with my name the way I do it, and the website and phone number, they had changed the phone number. I did not know what to do to help Angels Charge Ministry because people thought it was coming from Angels Charge Ministry. I changed passwords. I put stuff on Facebook. I don't know if anybody has any other ideas of what I could have done. I don't think it breached any data. It didn't come from Angels Charge Ministry's computer database. It came from me. Anybody have any thoughts on what to do, or if there is anything else I can do?
Do you have an IT person that you work with or an IT company? Did they help you with it?
No. I changed the password on my own, and I think it happened through Gmail, and I sent in a request to them saying that it had been hacked and to change it. And that's all I knew to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's scary. The folks that think about how they can hack into your systems and hack into your email. And when I was at the bank, I warned my clients to always, always check the email that they're getting something from, and never, you know, if someone is requesting dollars be wired, always pick up the phone and call that person. Even if they sit right next door to you, a lot of times when you get that email, it doesn't sound the same. They try to make it sound like it's you talking, but it just seems like there's something a little off. And I've seen email addresses where maybe one digit or one letter is off, and it goes someplace else and it doesn't go to that person. I've actually heard about attorneys who sent out emails about closing costs, and a hacker got a hold of it, and somebody sent their closing costs to, you know, a hacker instead of a law firm where they thought they were sending the money for their closing for their house or their building. So just always pick up the phone and call and check. And you just, we can't be too careful these days. It's so scary. I was listening because when Colonial Pipeline was had that ransomware attack at the beginning of the summer, they said that this hacker, and they called him the Dark Side. The Dark Side said that they would never go after a nonprofit entity, but yet they went after the third-party database provider that many of us use. So indirectly, they went after the nonprofits, which, you know, can happen so easily. And I'm sure they probably did not, it didn't matter to them because they're just looking for the cryptocurrency, the dollars.
Yeah. Well, this whole point has brought up to me that I need to make sure, and I don't know about, you know, all of the computers and the stuff that we have at Angels Charge that staff and everybody uses, but definitely we need to make sure we have everything as safe as possible.
Exactly. Yeah. So does anybody else, Ashley, do we have any other questions or comments?
Mm-hmm. Donald just shared that a fix for regarding the emails could be using a professional email service such as Constant Contact. This service is easy to learn and to use. So just using something to help us, using a professional email rather than your personal email for that type thing. And Teresa, I know because we received, you know, I received one of your emails mm-hmm. that I just sent it right back and said, is this you? You know, so I think you've done what you can do without having an IT company come in. I think you've done all you can do with notifying folks that it was an attack and it was not you. So hopefully folks were mindful of that. I'm going to have one last call for any additional questions or comments, or if there's something that you have seen at your organization that might be relevant to the group today that you haven't heard discussed on the call, I just welcome you to share that now. Using a VPN, yes, Karen. And that's a closed port. I can't explain it too well, but we've had that when we work remotely. A VPN basically is a secure port into your organization's files.
And always try to use a private, like your own personal router at your house, rather than a public, you know, Wi-Fi system. Like if you go to Starbucks or, you know, hotel, you know, I always carry a MiFi with me rather than tapping into a public Wi-Fi system. That just kind of opens it up as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Great.
Cybersecurity and cybercrime is on the rise, and it will continue to be because these criminals are out there and they're so smart, and they, you know, spend all this time developing these ways to hack hack companies, hack individuals, and where they could put their brains and their power to good use, they put it towards crime, which is really sad.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And if you all would like more information, perhaps we have a Nonprofit Connect session specifically around cybersecurity. Please put that in your survey evaluation that I'll send out in a follow-up email, and we'll take a look at our ability to do that, because I think it's certainly an important topic.
It's definitely a relevant topic. And I think, you know, I'm sure you have some insurance providers and folks that are probably more astute on cybercrime than I am, but definitely a relevant topic and one that we all need to be aware of.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, if there are no other questions, I have a few final announcements. and then we'll close out today's session. So a few upcoming events from the Spartanburg County Foundation. We do have an upcoming grant deadline on August 27th, and more information about our grants can be found on the foundation's website. Specifically, if you go to grants and then our apply for a grants page, you can find out about our two separate opportunities. One is related to sustainability and maintaining through the COVID-19 pandemic. It's a very broad application. And then the other application is focused on capacity building for people of color-led organizations. So more information can be found on the foundation's website, and our next deadline is August 27th. In September, we will have, for our Nonprofit Connect, we'll have Betty Parker of Sharper Development Solutions join us, and she'll be discussing self-care and overcoming compassion fatigue. We know especially this year has been very challenging. A lot of folks have been working long hours, and it seems that we can never do enough to help, but we have to take time to have self-care and look at bringing our best selves and how we can do that so that we can continue to serve and not become burned out in these roles. And then finally, I want to share that we are having the Spartanburg Community Thanksgiving service this year. We are still discussing the options. Certainly there will be a virtual option. We don't know at this time whether there'll be an in-person option, but we certainly are doing it virtually. And that will be on Tuesday, November 23rd at Temple Benai Israel. Many of you may know, we have a grant opportunity that's associated with the Community Thanksgiving service. We plan to announce that late August, early September, that opportunity where the offering from the Thanksgiving service is awarded to a nonprofit organization. So you'll be hearing more about that. That's just something to put to your radar. Again, I want to thank Kim Jolley for joining us today, sharing these tips on optimizing your budget and looking towards next year and how you can become efficient.
Thank you all.
Thank you all. So thank you for joining us today, and please be on the lookout for a follow-up email from me with this recording and with a survey. Thanks, everyone.